You want the RTX 5090. You want those 21,760 CUDA cores, 32 gigabytes of GDDR7 VRAM, and those three video encoders that could probably stream to Twitch from space. But here's the problem. You also want to pay rent, and you don't want to have to completely rewire the electrical in your house just to power this PC. So why don't you grab a stool and let's break down exactly who the 5090 is actually for, what you should be upgrading to probably instead, and how to get the best performance for your money without selling a kidney. Speaking of our money jiggling instead of folding, cheers to our wallets, because whether it's 5090s, potential tariffs on those 5090s, the power supplies that we need to power them, or the inevitable power bill that is gonna follow, our wallets are the ones that are gonna be taking the brunt of it for us. Cheers. All right, look, we've all seen this picture, right? Okay. And of course, we've seen this graph as well. But what does this actually mean? These FPS numbers inflated with AI frame generation? Some people are fine with that. Some people treat it like it's personally insulted their family. But either way, this is the story of the NVIDIA 5000 GPUs. So let's talk about it for just a second. Now, I really think that this conversation is being blown up, honestly, from both sides. At the end of the day, 90% of casual gamers and games that this is actually enabled for, that's going to probably help that experience. Who doesn't love some more frames, right? The biggest argument against these extra frames is going to be the extra response time. From testing so far that I've seen, it's probably going to be pretty negligible though, because most of us aren't playing competitively. It's been absolute fractions of a millisecond. It's not going to be a ton. Unless you're playing super competitively, unless you're playing something like Fortnite where you're already getting 200 frames per second, I think you're gonna be fine for the most part as far as latency goes. That being said, if you are noticing some latency, just turn DLSS off. Turn these frame generation things off and you'll be fine either way, right? It's still a powerful card. Either way, these cards are still going to have some serious power behind them, even without DLSS, right? And honestly, I think they are priced fairly solidly, at least at MSRP, if we're going to be able to find a card for that price anytime soon. But either way, when we strip the 5090 down to raw power, this is what we get. The 5090 has those 21,760 CUDA cores. The 4090? 16,384. And that old piece of trash 3090 Ti, an absolutely adorable 10,752 CUDA cores. So the 5090 has double that of the 3090 Ti, and yes, it has 32 gigabytes of GDDR7 memory on a 512-bit interface, meaning it's gonna be able to handle Cyberpunk 2077 at some pretty decent frame rates with or without DLSS and AI frame generation. So open your wallet. The 5090 is perfect for streamers, right? Well, let's talk about the other things that your wallet might not appreciate. With a power draw demand of about 575 watts, give or take, you're more than likely going to be upgrading your power supply along with this. The recommended 1000 watt power supply for these computers is a pretty tall order. And especially if you're planning on upgrading to a 5090, you're probably gonna want a CPU to match that, and the rest of the system is probably gonna be upgraded anyways. So at this point, the 5090 isn't just really an upgrade, it's more like a lifestyle choice. You're going to probably need a new PSU, you're probably going to need some better cooling, and possibly an excuse for why your lights are flickering every time you boot your system up. But for the budget-conscious streamers, this is where I gently nudge you towards literally anything else. But there are some other reasons why this actually might be the perfect card for streamers. Let's talk about encoders. When you're streaming, your GPU isn't just for gaming. It also encodes and compresses your stream so that platforms like Twitch and YouTube actually know what to do with it. The NVENC encoder, short for NVIDIA encoder, tricky, I know, right? Is a dedicated hardware component built onto these RTX GPUs. It's like having a tiny specialized video editor inside your graphics card whose only job is to encode video in real time. So why is this important for streamers? Because without this NVENC encoder, your CPU has to handle the encoding, which is kind of like asking someone that's watching this YouTube video to make sure that they like the video, they subscribe to your YouTube channel, and they keep watching this video all at the same time. Well, let's be honest. You can probably do that. You're a lot smarter than some of these CPUs, but either way, CPUs don't like doing that kind of stuff. By offloading the encoding to the NVENC encoder, your CPU gets to focus on the more important things, like running your games at higher FPS, handling everything else, like OBS, whatever you're using to play music, Discord, chatbots, overlays, the alerts, all without your stream stuttering, right? As well as not turning your PC into a giant space heater. Those things can get just as hot very, very quick. Okay, so ideally our GPU is doing the encoding, but why? Because each NVENC encoder supports multiple video compression formats, AKA codecs. There's no fancy acronym for that. That's just what they are. The ninth generation NVENC inside the RTX 5090 and all the other 5000 series cards supports H.264, H.265, as well as AV1. H.264 is the most standard, the one that streamers use all the time. It's reliable, but it's not the most efficient. H.265 is more efficient, but not nearly as supported on all of those platforms. And then AV1 is the absolute new hotness. It is ultra high quality at very low bit rates, making streams look super crisp without needing insane internet speeds. AV1 is the future of streaming, and platforms like YouTube and Twitch are starting to roll with it. Twitch, we're still waiting on you though. So now all of the 5000 series cards have ninth generation NVENC encoders. So any of them are going to do just fine, right? Well, the 5090, the 5090 doesn't just have one NVENC encoder, it has three. That's like having three bartenders here at the Pixel Pub, one pouring drinks, one serving them on a platter, and the other answering your tech questions at the same time. Actually, I mean, that kind of sounds like what I do, but hey, me and you are a lot more qualified than most of these computers, huh? But you kind of get the picture. So what exactly does having three encoders actually do? What, can I encode three streams at the same time? Doesn't exactly sound ideal. What does make sense though, is having multiple streams and recordings at the same time. You could easily be streaming to your Twitch channel at 1080p, recording exactly what's happening on that stream at 4K, as well as recording a clean version of just your gameplay, or maybe just your webcam, without all the overlays and alerts. Perfect for creators wanting that raw gameplay footage, or people that do a lot of editing of their VODs. It's probably just easier than streaming and then downloading the VOD from Twitch. This is also going to help with faster video encoding when editing. If you do edit your streams into YouTube content, which you probably should be, that's a whole nother conversation, the 5090's three NVENC encoders will help you export videos in Premiere and DaVinci Resolve so much faster. Normally, rendering a video takes forever because your system has to process every frame before saving it. But with multiple NVENC encoders, your GPU can split the workload between all three, making it so much more efficient. Less waiting, more content, more time for playing games. So let's recap the 5090 here real quick. Professional level multitasking while streaming and recording, triple the speed when rendering your videos, the absolute most raw performance out of any graphics card on the face of the planet. Your games are going to look absolutely crispy clean in 4K. So what's not to love about the 5090? Mostly the price. For most gamers, that $2,000 MSRP is just too much. So what should you upgrade to then? Well, if you own something already, like a 4080, 4080 Super, or a 4090, let me just save you some money at this point. You are fine. I wouldn't worry about it, unless you're already one of those billionaires that bought a 4090 on launch and you just have money burning a hole in your pocket and you have to have the newest card. Well, good luck trying to get one, but go for it. Otherwise, I wouldn't recommend upgrading at this. Do you want all of the latest and greatest AI-driven features? Cool, but DLSS 4 isn't that much different from DLSS 3, so again, you should probably be fine. Are you maybe streaming in 8K? Don't do that, probably, because your audience isn't watching in 8K, so... While we still wait for the full third-party benchmarks from all of the other 5000 series cards, the 5070 Ti, to me at least, is probably looking like the smartest upgrade, especially since it still has the two NVENC encoders, doesn't require you to sell a car to afford a new power supply. But hear me out for just a second. Maybe just pick up a 4070 Ti Super. With 16 gigabytes of VRAM, should still be plenty for 99% of streamers for the next couple of years, honestly. Not to mention, everything from the 4070 Ti and up actually includes two NVENC encoders as well. So three might be a little bit of overkill for that price. Or honestly, if you wanna be just like me, I have a 3080 Ti, and honestly, I think it's pretty fantastic. 12 gigabytes of VRAM and definitely no issues running 1440p gaming on my ultra wide. No problems from my end yet. They're still great cards, and honestly, with the 5090 and all the other 5000 series cards coming out, prices are all hopefully going to be seeing drops on the used marketplace here pretty soon. Either way, are you picking up a 5090 or any other 5000 series cards? Do you know what CPU you're gonna be pairing it with? Because you wanna make sure you have the right one. Make sure that you check out this video over here where I actually dove deep into what you need from a CPU to stream and game at the same time. We'll see you over there. Cheers.